Nancy and I have already had three people die this year, go to a funeral. And the astounding thing about this for us has been how many months ago he began preparing us for this month. And that's just such a cool thing to see. I realized, listening to Elena yesterday, that as a testimony, you're actually supposed to tell a little bit about who you are, and I had neglected that part. My whole testimony was like a man's shopping trip. It was just, I got to the point I wanted to make, and that's what I had to say. So I thank you. I had to rewrite it last night. I was raised, as many of us were, in an Adventist family. Mine, the uniqueness of mine was that my father's parents were consumed with rage. They would force he and his four brothers to go to the Friday night, whatever that meeting was called, something meeting on Friday night for youth. And then they'd come home and fight so bad that he wet the bed till he was 16. And he said that he thought it was because he was so afraid that one of his parents would be dead in the morning. I wonder what he thought of me wetting my bed until I was 14. Great way to start academy in the boarding school. My mother, on the other hand, was raised by loving Adventist parents, but who were so Adventist that they didn't actually like anybody. unless, of course, they behaved perfectly. So my father, who smoked and drank and swore, you know, the perfect trifecta of sin there, and I, who was just his kid, they never liked us much. And I don't know how that impacted me, but I do know that when I went off to boarding school, to start high school, that I had already been told many times to pray for my father. And then it began to be, God has a mighty work for you to do. And that was usually followed by, if only you'd behave, if only you'd try harder. He's so gifted you, you're so smart. He has. And of course, at that time, you know, back when I was in high school in the 40s, they were teaching still. They were very hardcore into the harvest principle. How many of you know instantly what I meant? Christ would have come ere this if you lazy, good-for-nothing worms would have gotten the work done. He could have come. And I so took that to heart. I was horrified when Dennis Pierce and I were following a car down the road, and a dog ran out in front of that car, and the guy ran over it. And we had to pick this not-dead dog up and take it to this old man who told us that their dog of 17 years had just died, and they'd gotten this puppy to replace it. And would we please go bury it for him? Oh, but here's my gun, so you can kill it for us first. It was horrible, and I was absolutely convinced it was because my parents hadn't done their work. So, of course, I entered into life with this huge load of, I've got to find God's will for my life. Well, I didn't. I spent decades trying to figure out what that was. And so I'd leave a job or leave a business or just change all the time because, well, this isn't what God wants me to do. And multiple wives and lots of kids paid dearly for my chaos. All right, so why am I standing up here now? A general theme of testimonies, I think, is that there's supposed to be something the person has learned that's of value. So I have learned. I learned there were two fundamental truths of Adventism that I had absorbed, and hopefully they'll appear on the screen now. One was to argue about everything, making sure you never reached any actual conclusions. Rule of Adventism in your life. And number two, the Holy Bible was inspired by God, but the only people that could understand it were Adventist theologians. And of course, by definition, non-Adventist theologians obviously didn't understand it, so don't ever read anything any of them have ever written, because that's proof you're on the slippery slope, if you ever remember that term. I think those two are fundamental principles that you would be wise to keep in mind when you're trying to reach out to your Adventist friends and family? Because frankly, I studied Adventist theology at the seminary from a guy named Griggs, who taught us carefully for an entire quarter, line by line, why you could not trust the Bible. I remember in particular his example of going carefully through the Exodus story of creation and the Genesis story of creation and showing us how they contradict each other. The days are reversed on day three. So obviously the Bible is not the inerrant, inspired word of God. And isn't it great? We have a lesser light to illuminate the greater light, and presto, now we have room for the spirit of prophecy. Well, that was rampant in the Adventist world, this idea that the Bible doesn't matter. Well, so how can you go convince your Adventist friend that they're in error by using Bible texts? They don't believe in the Bible. The arguing thing, I didn't think much of that actually until I was trying to think of something of value to say to you guys. That wasn't one of the jokes in the script, folks. This was... I realized that this is endemic in the culture that I was raised in. I mean, think about it. Between arguing and having to change our story, which, of course, not believing in the Bible, that helped to be able to have permission to change our story. But think of the culture we were raised in. First, we had to change the date of the second coming, a fairly impactful event in human history. We didn't even get that right. And then, early on, we had to change the date of the closed door issue because, you know, the ungrateful common people kept having babies and the leaders' kids were already in the closed doors. That was a problem. We had to change that. And then, of course, the leader of the Say Anything You Want at the Time movement would go off and have a vision when she was 20 that said one thing and another vision when she was 50 that said the exact opposite. How many of you have ever sat in a Sabbath school class where the point of the Sabbath school class was try and upstage the teacher? You've got to say something more insightful than the teacher, or you aren't allowed in the potluck or something. It was sport. But in my life, it meant that when I said to the kids, well, yeah, I think we can go to Disneyland next Sunday, what it actually meant was, well, you'll be really happy for a few hours if I say we're going to Disneyland. I have no idea if I have the money to go to Disneyland or not, but since I'm allowed to change my mind at any time and I don't really have to speak truth because there isn't actually any real truth, I couldn't believe when I began to look at this how much of my life had been impacted by these two things. Well, I finally gave up. I just left the church. Gee, nobody's ever done that before. I just left everything for 5 years, like so many Adventists do. But my Adventist mother and my Adventist grandmother, the one who didn't like me, kept after me, and Richard Brown, whose funeral... whose funeral I'll be at in a little while. He gave me this book, Eternity in Their Hearts, by its author. his name is here somewhere, by Richardson. You know, basically where he traces these cultures from throughout history that all came to a monotheistic belief system, but there's no indication they ever had contact with each other or with Western civilization. So how did they do that? Well, a wonderful book. It took away the first standard Adventist default of agnosticism. I knew there was a God. I couldn't escape that this guy had proved that there must be a God, a supreme being. Well, then my mom got me to read Philip Yancey's What's So Amazing About Grace. And I lost the argument that God's off playing golf somewhere and isn't really interested in us. He just so convinced me that God is worth engaging with and wants to have a good relationship with us, a beneficial relationship with us. But the one that began to make it possible for me to come back was Lee Strobel's A Case for Christ. Only time I'd ever heard of a scientific discussion of whether or not the Bible was legitimate. Well, I'm an American. I think scientific ease. As do all of you. That's the way our culture works. We want to know what the latest study says. It doesn't matter if it's an accurate study. We just want to know what the study says. We want to know what the facts are. whether they're made up or not. That's the way we think. And Strobel does such a great job of laying out a foundation of, yes, the Bible can be believed. I think that made it possible for me then to engage in actually learning and studying. Well, this was amazing. It equipped me then for the next piece of the puzzle, which was my girlfriend, Nancy at the time, gave me a book that nobody here has ever heard of, but it was Walter Martin's Kingdom of the Cults revised edition, the one with the appendix about Adventism. Except I was ignorant enough of all the issues that I thought he thoroughly discredited Adventists, and I was released. Well, I had been suspicious of all that stuff too, and so it was like, well, shoot, this guy thinks they're a little loopy. I know that their religion doesn't work because it didn't transform my life or anybody I knew, so I was gone. I was out of the church and happy as a clam. Nancy was fairly pleased too that we didn't have to go to two churches every weekend anymore. But unfortunately, I finally had everything I wanted. I had a wife that actually liked the idea of living with me. I had a career that was rewarding. Everything was fine. Except that, read between the lines with me here, guys. You know that I have a child that's in my care. The world's happiest person. But I would get angry at him. How do you do that? And I'm going to church here at Trinity, and they're having these services where they're singing about Jesus, and the songs are about Jesus, and the service is about Jesus, and Jesus, everything. And I'm going, when does this thing end? I couldn't understand why I was essentially the same angry, scared, anxious person I'd always been, except with a happier wife. And on a day where I got so mad that I actually knocked my stepson down and scared the snot out of him because I was so angry, and then sat through a service where I didn't resonate with any of it, Nancy walked in and gave me a copy of an article, and I want to read you something I read in it, and you see if you can tell me what magazine it was and who the author was, both of the article and the quote. You've got to give you something to do here. Yet into the world where Satan claimed dominion, God permitted his son to come, a helpless babe subject to the weakness of humanity. He permitted him to meet life's peril in common with every human soul, to fight the battle as every child of humanity must fight it, at the risk of failure and eternal loss. Know what book it is yet? The heart of the human father yearns over his son. He looks into the face of his little child and trembles at the thought of life's perils. He longs to shield his dear one from Satan's power, to hold him back from temptation and conflict, to meet a bitterer conflict and a more fearful risk. God gave his only begotten son that the path of light may be sure for our little ones. Well, that's from that demonic-inspired Desire of Ages. I'm sure it's highlighted in my Desire of Ages of my youth as my favorite passage about Jesus. I didn't realize that it was teaching me he was a second-class citizen and not really of much good. And the author, Talbot, in that issue of Proclamation magazine, completely dismisses this as lunatic raging, and I realized, oh my goodness, I believe this stuff. I have no idea what kind of garbage is buried inside of me that's still affecting the way I think and the way I view life. Well, I had already met you all. I had come to hear Dale speak. Richard Brown actually had told me about the conference, staunch Adventist to the day he died, and we had come. And we had listened, and it was all about Adventists and what freaks they are. And then I went to one of the FATF Friday night Bible studies, and that was all about Adventists and what freaks they are. And I said, oh, wow, I feel bad for you folks because you're so obsessed with Adventists, and I don't want anything to do with them. And I left. Didn't come back for a couple years, during which that time I was miserable. Well, y'all were getting rid of your poison. so I began. I began reading the proclamations, and I read all those books back there on the tables, and I began getting permission and hearing you saying, hearing the teacher saying, yeah, you actually do get to believe the Bible, and you actually get to read it in context and at face value, and listening to Gary preach and listening to Andrew Farley from the Church Without Religion, if any of you know of him out in Texas. And God began to work in me to give me head knowledge that allowed room for heart knowledge. Now, I know that a lot of people, I've always loathed Dave Wilkerson. He got converted in an instant. And the guy, you read the books of the people who heard a sermon and whoo, forever on they were changed because something happened in their heart. And I always wanted that. But much to my delight, God has treated me as who I am. And he's gotten to me through my head as I came to understand stuff. I find that very encouraging because I think our culture is obsessed with their thoughts and that God would stoop to reach us in the way we think, or at least me. Because I began to find stuff that painted him a way I understood him. Do you know the verse where God's jumping up and down and waving his arms? You know the verse I'm talking about? I'm sure somebody else has discovered this. Isaiah, I permitted myself to be found by those who did not ask for me. I permitted myself to be found by those who did not seek me. I said, here am I, to a nation which did not call on my name. That's the creator of the universe that was trying to get my attention. I've begun to grasp that the Spirit of God actually dwells inside me. There's a little bit of evidence to support that. I began to resonate that maybe that Spirit was the answer to this trying to find God's will that I always had. And Isaiah again, your ears will hear a word behind you. This is the way. Walk in it. I never could understand how to get him to speak up. Yeah, it's fine that he's saying it, but I can't hear him. It was kind of how I felt as I'd first seen that verse, but I began to understand that I was listening with the wrong ears. And of course, what we've heard here today about emptying out what's already there to make room for the Spirit. And maybe it involves turning off Netflix even. Well, not probably not Netflix, but at least turning off cable TV, maybe. And verses that talk about a yoke that's easy and a burden that's light. But the one that really caught my attention, because all of this, for me, involves surrender. I'm a man. I'm supposed to take care. I'm supposed to provide. I'm supposed to make things happen. I'm a self-employed businessman. I'm really supposed to make things happen. Ephesians 6, verse 4. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord. Well, I'd read that before, and I knew full well it wasn't anything you could trust, because after all, the Bible can't be understood, and God isn't really trustworthy. But boy, now, well, wait a minute. This is the inerrant, inspired word of my Creator. Why in the world would he have Paul tell this is how human fathers are supposed to do it if he was going to do it different? And sure enough, a few months ago, as I really began pushing into the idea of, no, I'm not going to figure it out. No, I'm not going to plan it out. I'm going to relax it out or something like that and let God work. I began seeing little by little by little by little these things. We're a good percentage of women, so I can tell you this. Nancy and I went back to see my mom because with everybody that I knew dying, I was pretty sure I needed to go visit my mom. And so I went back to upstate New York and went to see mom. And we went for dinner on the way back at a little New England inn kind of place that we didn't know about. We just asked for referral, and we ended up at this place. And we didn't know what time to go, but we ended up with the best seat in the place. And they had set their wood-burning stove so that it leaked smoke out into the room, which, of course, in a restaurant worked okay because of the big exhaust fan in the kitchen. It just traveled through. So it had the smell of wood smoke in the air the whole time. And as we left from this fantastic meal, it was snowing, but with a full moon. Now, that's hard to pull off, but it was. And it was like the perfect thing for my wife, raised down in El Centro, who'd never even seen the snow before. It was just the neatest end to a wonderful meal. And I just was, oh God, you have arranged everything, every detail of every day. Well, let me conclude. I'm guessing, since Richard's standing waving his arms, that I've probably gone past my 4 minutes that I was allowed. I have to give you a quote from the Bible. And the interesting thing is it's gone. Because it's a quote from the even clearer word. The even clearer word by Julius Botelho. Oh, here we go. This is what I've decided is the answer for how to reach Adventists and how to live my life. If I loathe the spirit of prophecy and know all the fallacies of their religion, and if I can argue loud enough to get a mountain to move but do not love, I am nothing. And if I give all my possessions to pay for the printing of proclamation and surrender my testimonies to be burned but do not have love, it profits me nothing. Not arguing, accepting the Bible, and love abide these three, but the greatest of these is love.